that's just fine. Hello, everybody, and welcome to tonight's talk on Engaging Racism, Conversations for Change. My name is Fran Berry, and I'm delighted to be emceeing tonight. And I'm also admitting people into the room. My good friend and colleague who I respect and admire so much is with us tonight, Professor Maxine Jones. Professor Jones is a professor in the Department of History at FSU. She is also head of the Women's Studies Program in the Department of History. And she has a long and distinguished research career, as well as teaching on African-American history in Florida in specific. She published a book on this, and in a quite unusual act, she was commissioned by the Florida legislature in the early 90s to write a report on Rosewood, which is what she'll be talking about tonight, and to make the case for reparations or for trying to repair the damage, though damage of violence like that can never be fully repaired. Also, Dr. Jones has been very active on campus. She has won she was awarded the MLK award for her volunteer service in the community and at FSU. She served as the Title IX coordinator on the athletic committee at FSU for over a decade. And she was currently just recently appointed by President Thrasher on the President's Task Force on Diversity, Inclusion, and Equity. And she'll be heading up the subcommittee on historical legacy, I think it's called. So I hope that maybe we can get her to make a few words about what that subcommittee is going to be considering also. So without further ado, let me introduce Dr. Maxine Jones.
And thank you.
I'll put you on the speaker with you here.
Okay, thank you so much for sharing part of your Tuesday evening with me. I would like to talk to you about Rosewood. I would like to walk you through that week in January of 1923, and then talk about the legislative process a little bit that ended up awarding money to the families involved. So the beginning of the new year for the residents of Rosewood, Florida, changed their lives forever. Instead of the traditional optimism that every new year brings, life ended for several, and those who survived the incident that began on January 1st, 1923, were scarred for life. Rosewood, about 9 miles east of Cedar Key, was a small, close-knit community of about 20 families, many of whom were related by marriage. Although predominantly African American, there were a few white families in Rosewood. The residents owned their homes, some of which were furnished lavishly. They owned land and other property. There was a school, two churches, and a Masonic lodge. It was a proud and self-sustaining community. The residents were either self-employed or they worked as worked at the Comer Lumber Mill in Sumner. Some of the women worked as maids for white families in the area. And some of the families living in Rosewood included the Carriers, the Goings, the Bradleys, the Halls, the Edwards, and the Carters. Monday, January 1st, 1923. Early that morning, Fanny Taylor reports an attack by an unidentified Black man. The 22-year-old housewife and mother claimed that she had been assaulted and robbed by a Black man. She was bruised and apparently very upset. Whites assumed that she had been sexually assaulted and began to search for the person responsible. Now, there are two versions of what happened on that morning, that Monday morning. Blacks claim that Fannie Taylor had been beaten by her white lover, and to explain her bruises to her husband, she accused a black man of assaulting her. In fact, Mrs. Sarah Carrier, the matriarch of Rosewood, was actually present at Mrs. Taylor's house on that fateful morning. She was there to do laundry for the Taylors, and she was accompanied by her 9-year-old granddaughter. And Sarah Carrier said that she saw a white man visit Fannie Taylor just before she made her accusations. A group of white men organized to search for Fannie Taylor's alleged attacker. In the meantime, the Levy County Sheriff, Bob Walker, had been informed that Jesse Hunter, a black convict, had escaped from a chain gang doing road construction work in the area. And Hunter was assumed to be the attacker. Sheriff Walker ordered hound dogs or bloodhounds, which led them to Rosewood. Monday afternoon, Aaron Carrier, 26 years old, is apprehended by a posse and is spirited out of the area by Sheriff Walker. Almost killed, Carrier may have implicated Sam Carter. And apparently what happened is that the man who allegedly attacked Fannie Taylor went into Rosewood and sought help from Aaron Carrier, who led him to Sam Carter. And Sam Carter apparently gave the man who apparently attacked Taylor transportation. So the bloodhounds led the white men to Sam Carter's house, and this is late Monday afternoon. Carter was a 45-year-old blacksmith. He lived between Sumner and Rosewood, and he admitted that he had befriended someone by hitching up his horse and wagon and providing that person with transportation. Now, apparently, this alleged attacker was a Mason. And Aaron Carrier and Sam Carter were Masons as well. And even though Masons were segregated, the secret fraternal of society, they had a set of rules that they obeyed. And so apparently this one Mason went to another Mason and asked for help. And this will lead to the violence that takes place this week. So Carter will be strung up over a tree limb and forced to talk. He will be tortured and shot, and his body will be left lying in the road. That was late Monday afternoon. On Tuesday, January 2nd, Carter's body was found. And later that same day, a coroner's jury held an inquest, and it was signed, the verdict was signed by a man named L.L. Johns. He was the justice of the peace. And they determined, and I quote, "We the jury, after the examination of the said Sam Carter, who being found lying dead, find that the said Sam Carter came to his death by being shot by unknown parties, so say we all. So armed whites began gathering in Sumner on Tuesday, and it was fairly quiet. It was quiet on Wednesday as well, and I've since learned that a storm moved into the area, evidently Tuesday night, Wednesday morning, and that may explain why things were unusually quiet. And then on Thursday, January 4th, is when things really get out of hand. This is late Thursday evening when white vigilantes will attack the Carrier house. Minnie Lee Langley and Arnett Goings were young children at the time. They were present at the house. And they will testify as adults, as elderly adults, before the special master here in Tallahassee. And they said that they had been told that they were to expect trouble, and all of the members of the Carrier family and some other relatives gathered at one place for their protection. The kids and the women were taken upstairs to a bedroom. And Sylvester Carrier, who is a major player in what takes place this week, is prepared to defend his family. So a group of white men come to their house. They will come up to the porch. On the way to the porch, they will shoot a dog that is tied out in the yard. They call for Sarah Carrier to come out. She did not respond. So they came up to the porch, and according to the testimony, one of the men, whose name was C.P. Poley Wilkerson, he was about 45, a former quarter boss from Sumner, and now he was a merchant and mail official. He kicked in the door. And when he kicked in the door, he was immediately shot and killed by Sylvester Carrier. Now, Sylvester Carrier was about 32 years old. He was a hunter and a marksman, also a music teacher. He was a very proud and independent man, and he had been married since 1912 to a woman named Maddie Matilda Smith. He was highly regarded in the community. He was active in Rosewood's AME Church, and he was determined to protect his family. A second white man, Henry Andrews, he was 42 years old, and he was superintendent of the Cummer Lumber Mill. He tried to enter the house, and he was also shot and killed by Sylvester Carrier. The remaining white men retreated, and gunfire was exchanged. During the ensuing gunfire, Sarah Carrier was shot and killed. The white men, apparently running out of ammunition, left or retreated. And during the respite, the children were taken out of the house by older relatives, and they escaped into the woods and swamps of Gus Hammock. So Sarah Carrier is killed along with the two white men, and several others are wounded. Family members claim that Sylvester Carrier escaped. Now, as researchers, we found no clues that he did. But family members claim that for many years afterwards, they received a Christmas card from him. But he is counted among the dead. So in the meantime, Rosewood's Black residents flee into the cold, wet swamp for protection from the whites. That night, one black church is burned and several unprotected homes. Lexi Gordon is also murdered that night. She is 50 years old, half Native American. She was sick, probably with typhoid, and she was unable to she was unable to leave her house for safer quarters. So either she ran out the back door or she was under the house, and when they torched it, she ran from under the house and she was shot and killed. So that was Thursday. Again, a number of houses was burned along with a church, and there were several deaths, black and white, that night. And then on Friday, January 5th, approximately 200 to 300 whites from surrounding areas began to converge on Rosewood. And Mingo Williams, a black man who has nothing to do with Rosewood, he was some 20 miles away, but he encounters this mob of white men coming into Rosewood, and they kill him, even though he has absolutely nothing to do with what was going on in Rosewood. Also on Friday, January 5th, the governor of Florida, Carrie Hardee, is informed of what's going on. Sheriff Walker told the governor that he thought he had everything under control. He didn't fear any other disorder. And so the governor goes hunting. The sheriff from Alachua County comes in to assist Sheriff Walker. And evidently, that mob that was on his way into Rosewood arrived. And it appeared as if they were going into Sumner to the lumber mill, to the quarter section where black workers lived. And the superintendent of the mill, of course, did not want to disrupt business, wanted to protect the black man who worked at the mill. He is going to make an exchange. So James Carrier, who is Sylvester Carrier's brother and Sarah's son, is basically going to be given to the mob in exchange for leaving the lumber mill quarter alone. Now, James Carrier had suffered from a stroke, and he was not, you know, completely healthy. And the story is that he is going to be taken to the black cemetery, where beside the fresh graves of his mother and brother, he will be forced to dig his own grave and then shot. Saturday, January 6th, a train arrives to evacuate the women and children. The Bryce brothers were the men who operated that train, and they were familiar with the residents of Rosewood. And so they decided to go and get the women and children, no men, but women and children who were still hiding in the swamps. And Minnie Lee Langley recalled that it was cold, and I'm using her words, man, it was cold. Jesus, I will never forget that day. So the Bryce brothers comes to evacuate the refugees. John Wright was a white store owner who lived in Rosewood. He knew the residents of Rosewood really well. He did business with them. He actually hid some of the children in his house. And And some of the whites in the area will befriend some of the blacks in Rosewood, especially the blacks who worked in the private homes. Families will try to protect them. Excuse me. And then on Sunday, a mob of 100 to 150 white men returned to Rosewood, and they burned the remaining structures. And again, Minnie Lee Langley remembered, and I quote, "All of our houses were destroyed. They burned every house in that town. That included churches and everything. They left nothing. Took all our chickens and cows and everything from us. We could see the fire burning." And again, Rosewood is completely destroyed. On January 29th, Governor Kerry Hardee ordered that a special grand jury investigate the violence at Rosewood. A grand jury convened in Bronson, the county seat, to investigate the Rosewood riot on February 11th. And then on February 15th, the grand jury announced its findings: insufficient evidence to prosecute. So no charges were ever brought by the state of Florida against any person or persons for the assault on Francis Taylor, for the killing of Sam Carter, for the deaths occurring at the Carrier home on the night of January 4th, for the deaths of Lexi Gordon, James Carrier, or Mingo Williams. Neither was anyone ever charged with arson and theft, which occurred at Rosewood. So for more than 60 years, the story of Rosewood had been kept secret. Survivors' fear of reprisals never sought redress. Some were married for over 50 years and never mentioned the incident to their spouses. Others never even talked about it with each other. And those who did share their horrible nightmare made their listeners take a vow of silence. And the shocking thing about all of this is that there was no outrage from white society at all. And then in 1982, Gary Moore, a reporter for the St. Pete Times, uncovered and wrote a feature story on Rosewood. He generally wrote for the weekend edition of the newspaper about places to visit and so forth. And he went to Cedar Key to do a story on that town. And while he was there, some white guy asked if he knew why there weren't any black people in Cedar Key, and proceeded to tell him about what had happened that first week in January, and bragged about having Sam Carter's ear or fingers or something, of the nature. And it wasn't uncommon when things like this happened for people to want souvenirs. And so fingers and toes and ears and pieces of chain and so forth were often taken as souvenirs. So Gary Moore wrote a story in 1982. And then in 1983, 60 Minutes actually did a report, apparently found some survivors and took some of them back there. So this was a week of terror, and the trauma from those memories became, intergenerational, as survivors raised their children in an environment of silence and fear. But the children of those survivors refused to live in the silence and fear that had trapped their parents. And thus, they brought that week of terror to the attention of the state in 1993. And let me just set the stage just a little bit. Philomena Goins was the 9-year-old little girl who was at the house of Fannie Taylor on January 1st. And she was so psychologically scarred by what happened that week, and especially that Thursday night, that she suffered from a depression, probably post-traumatic stress syndrome. And her children noticed that every year around Christmas, her demeanor changed. She went into this a depression. Finally, they convinced her to tell them why, and she shared with them the story of Rosewood, but made them a promise never, ever to talk about it with anybody outside of the family. And as her kids grew up, and they understood the weight which their mother, I guess, was under, they wanted to do something about it. And her son, Arnett, said he was going to publicize it. And even though he was a grown man, his mother slapped him and said that she prohibited him or forbade him from doing it. I don't know the year she died, but it was probably the late 80s or early 90s. But after her death, he brought this forward. And Holland and Knight, the largest law firm in Florida, represented the claimants and asked for $7.2 million. Martha Barnett and Steve Hanlon were the attorneys. And in 1993, Representatives Miguel DeGrande and Al Lawson and Senator Darrell Jones filed a claims bill seeking a compensation for those injured by the violence at Rosewood. Bo Johnson was the Speaker of the House, and he commissioned a thorough, objective, and scholarly study of the events surrounding the destruction of Rosewood. And in 1994, an academic research team led by myself and consisting of Dr. William Rogers of FSU, Dr. Larry Rivers of FAMU, Dr. David Colburn of the University of Florida, an FSU graduate student, Tom Dye. So we conducted this study, and we had a very short window in which to do this. We probably started in August or September, and our report was due in December. So we had to do in a matter of months what it should have taken, you know, several years to do. We did get to meet many of the survivors. They were children at the time. Minnie Lee Langley and Arnett Goings, among others, finally had the opportunity to tell their stories. And again, I wish I could show you their pictures. They were definitely shaped by the events that took place that first week of January, and they riveted the audience with their stories. So hearings are held, and they got to tell their stories. Their stories made the CBS News or the national news almost every evening. The BBC and other international media were also interested in the study. So these survivors tell their stories, and there is a lot of skepticism, you know, from the public. There are letters to the editor saying that, you know, this happened so long ago that that citizens in the 1990s should not be responsible for something that had happened in the 1920s. And we had to do a lot of investigative work ourselves, and our research will help us to find someone who could corroborate that story or the stories that were being told. And I won't go into all of the details there, but Ernest Parham was a white man who lived in Rosewood. And when Rosewood took place, he was either 17 or 18 years old. I think his stepfather owned maybe a boarding house or a hotel or something in Cedar Key. And he was able to corroborate what many of the Black survivors had been saying. And so his testimony was crucial. So based on our study and the testimony from the survivors and other witnesses, Richard Hickson, who was the special master, claimed in the report that he filed, and I quote him, "As a matter of law, the record does not demonstrate that the claimants could overcome the state's objections if these proceedings were judicial in nature." Claim bill proceedings, however, address the moral obligations of the state and are matters purely within the prerogative of the legislature. And contending that it was the moral obligation of the state, Hickson recommended to the Speaker of the House that HB 591, as presented by DeGrande and Lawson, be amended as follows. One, the bill should direct the Florida Department of Law Enforcement or other appropriate law enforcement officials to conduct a complete investigation of this matter, including interviewing the available witnesses to determine if any criminal proceedings may still be pursued. Two, a fund should be established to compensate the Rosewood families who can demonstrate a property loss as a result of the displacement of the Rosewood residents. Three, the elderly claimants who sustained emotional trauma as a result of the destruction of Rosewood and the evacuation of the residents should each be compensated in the amount of $150,000. And four, a state university scholarship fund should be established for the families and the descendants of the Rosewood residents. Now, Hickson's favorable recommendation did not guarantee that the bill would meet the approval of the House and the Senate. On March 31st, 1994, 19 African American legislators in Florida realize and utilize, perhaps for the first time in the 20th century, their political clout. And sensing that the Rosewood Compensation Bill might be defeated in the House of Representatives, the Black Caucus decided to play hardball by putting pressure on Governor Lawton Childs. Even though Governor Childs supported the measure, The Black Caucus believed that he should use his influence more actively to secure enough votes for passage. They threatened to withdraw their support for the governor's healthcare package unless he lobbied more vigorously for their piece of legislation. On April 4th, the House passed the Rosewood Compensation Bill by 31 votes, and 4 days later, the Senate voted 24-16 in its favor. The Black Caucus's shrewd tactical move guaranteed the passage of a measure that had come to represent to thousands of Black Floridians an acknowledgement for past wrongs and hope for the future of race relations. It also symbolized the distance traveled and the political strength that African Americans had gained since the turn of the century. On May 4th, 1994, Governor Lawton Chiles signed an approximately $2.1 million of compensation bill into law. Now, we remember they had asked for $7.2 million, but $2.1 million is awarded. And before affixing his signature to this controversial measure, Governor Chiles said, and I quote, "Ignorance and racial hatred can lead to death and destruction. Let us use the lesson of Rosewood to promote healing." Several books, movies have been published dealing with Rosewood. In 1996, Michael D'Orso published Black Judgment Day, The Rise and Redemption of a Town Called Rosewood, or The Ruin and Redemption of a Town Called Rosewood. In 1997, John Singleton will direct the movie, Rosewood, which starred Ving Rhames, John Voight, Esther Roll, and Don Cheadle. The academic study that we wrote is available online. And in 2004, a historical marker was placed in Rosewood. Governor Jeb Bush attended the ceremony and dedicated the marker. And sadly, 2 weeks after the marker was placed, it was vandalized. And again, I wish I could show you the picture. The historical marker at Rosewood is, at the time, was one of about 700 in the state. And it is the state's most vandalized marker. It has been vandalized several times. Over the years, it has been sawed from its post, attacked with an axe, ripped out of the ground with a truck, and dragged down the highway, often turning up in Cedar Key or along the side of the road leading into Rosewood, State Road 24. It's been shot at. Each time, it's been restored. The last major improvement involved pouring 480 pounds of concrete around the base. That made it harder to yank out of the ground, but it didn't stop people from breaking off the marker at the post. So the state of Florida, and I'm not sure if this is something to be proud of or not, but the state of Florida holds the distinction of being the first state to formally acknowledge the racial terror committed against its Black citizens and to award financial compensation. So that includes the formal part of my speech. I do want to add just one more thing, something which took place about a week ago. Congressman Yoho, of Florida, introduced a bill to authorize the Secretary of the Interior to conduct a special resource study of Rosewood. And this resource source study is the first step in designating Rosewood as a national historic landmark. The National Park Service, if this bill is passed, will conduct the study to determine whether a given site is an appropriate, candidate for inclusion in the national park system. So some progress is being made in acknowledging what happened in Rosewood. It's a shame that the historical marker is vandalized. I do know that there are some students currently at FAMU who were awarded the Rosewood Fellowship. There's a very nice article in the Washington Post a few months ago. And the four or five students who were there didn't even know each other. And it must be strange. It's not a badge of honor, to wear, knowing knowing everything that comes with having been a victim, but yet a survivor of what took place in 1923. And it's unfortunate that nothing was done at the time to help these people to reclaim their lives and their property. And, while their property was lost, way more than that was lost, the ability to pass a legacy from one generation to the next. Minnie Lee Langley wanted to be a nurse, and her grandmother had promised to help her become a nurse. That dream died that first week in January. That sense of community that had held these families together will also die. And I can't think of a worse feeling than a parent being unable to protect their children. And so these kids who are going to receive a compensation from the state, you can't put a monetary price on what they suffered. But I think more than anything else, it was the acknowledgement from the state of Florida that it had failed to protect its Black citizens in that situation. So if you have any questions, I am more than happy to attempt to answer them.
Thank you so much, Maxine. What a powerful talk and very sad subject, but one that resonates in today's environment where we're looking back at our history and searching our souls for how to redeem the evils that we have perpetrated on each other. We do have a number of questions. How about if I, with Sarah's help, unmute the people that have asked. Todd Clark, would you like to ask your question, Todd? I'm trying to find you.
Where they could put their questions in the chat and someone could read them?
Yeah, that's what he's done. I guess I'll have to read it. I can't seem to find Todd on point him. He asked if there were newspaper accounts of the incident at the time that it occurred. Did any of the newspapers in the state cover it?
Yes. This was a story that was covered, you know, nationally. I thought I had a comment from a Jacksonville newspaper. I don't know if I can find it or not, but it was very descriptive. But yes, we use newspaper accounts along with the interviews from the survivors to put our story together. And there are some pictures. Again, I couldn't use it in my, I couldn't use my PowerPoint, but there is a picture of one of the houses burning in Rosewood. So this is from the Jacksonville Times Union on January 8th, and it reads, "Masses of twisted steel were all that remained of furniture formerly in the Negro homes, and several charred bodies of dogs and firearms left in the hasty retreat bore evidence to the mob's fury, which set fire to the Negro section of Rosewood." So there are newspaper accounts, but many of them are very similar, because I think things that they had were stringers who collected stories or who wrote a story, and then it was sold to various newspapers or something similar to that. So a lot of the stories are almost word for word.
Okay, thank you. Betty Soro, would you like to ask your question? I'm trying to unmute you, Betty.
Sure. I'm curious, do you have a sense of why everybody wanted to keep this a secret?
This is generally how these things happened. I don't know if there was, you know, everyone's in a fury. There's mob psychology, that mob psychology. And once everything had quieted down, I don't know if whites took a vow of silence, you know, as well. But I'm not sure. But it wasn't uncommon. I mean, these things happen more than we realize. And if it wasn't for organizations such as the NAACP who collected these incidents, we wouldn't be able to write, you know, our report. And it's interesting that even though there were six blacks killed, only one of them was considered a victim of a lynching, and that was Sam Carter. The others were victims of mob violence. We know why blacks didn't, you know, talk about, you know, these stories. And I think for a lot of whites, it was, well, you know, we've cleared the air, we've reminded blacks of who they are and where their place is and where their place is in society. We don't have to worry about this for a while. But in December of 1922, there had been lynchings in Perry. A white school teacher had been killed, and black men were blamed, and brutal murders there. And in Gainesville, right before the end of the year, and I may have my dates mixed up just a little bit, but there was a huge Klan rally in December. And so again, this isn't not something that just happened. This was something that happened, you know, often, and just swept under the rug. Now, Rosewood was rural, and it still is, and maybe the fact that it took place in a rural area helped to, you know, keep it secret, but I'm not sure.
Okay, thank you. Linda, why don't you ask your question, Linda Milkowitz?
I'm muted.
Okay, not anymore.
Oh, thank you. The description of this, and I was a newspaper reporter in the 70s and at the Gainesville Sun, I had known about this. But now it reminds me of what happened in Tulsa to Black Wall Street, I think around maybe 1921. Yes. And I wonder if this may have been an impetus for those, for the mobs in, for the mob in Rosewood to do what they did.
I doubt it. In 1920 in Ocoee, right before an election, blacks were exercising their right to vote, and violence broke out. And they destroyed the black area in Ocoee. All blacks were forced to leave. There, they were, their land was purchased from them, but not at market price. So at least they received something for their land. The people in Rosewood, you know, did not. And so I don't think it had anything to do with what had happened in Tulsa, or what had happened in Elaine, Arkansas, and other places, especially when a white woman claims to be a victim. White malehood somehow thinks they have to avenge her honor. And Fannie Taylor never said that she was sexually, you know, assaulted. She just said that, you know, she had been assaulted. And again, according to the story from the black community, she had been beaten up by her lover, and she had to explain her, she had to explain her bruises to her husband. So she, you know, so she blamed the black man. So I don't think what happened in Tulsa led whites in the area to do what they did. These things just happened because white men felt they had to keep those white women up on that pedestal. Mm.
Thank you.
Yes. Are there plans to fix the marker, Susan asked?
Every time the marker is vandalized, it is restored.
Patrick, I can't find you. Could you put your, if you could put your video on, there you are. I'll unmute you so you can ask your question. Dr. Mason.
Yes. Okay. Thank you, Maxine. That was great.
Hey, Patrick.
Is there any ongoing research related to Ocoee and the other incidents of anti-black violence? Indeed, is there some kind of, it seems to me there are a lot of these incidents, and it would be great to have some kind of publication that brought all of this stuff together. Is there anything?
Yes, there is. In Orlando, a committee, I don't know the name of the committee, but they make certain that what happened in Ocoee is in the public's eye. The one man who was killed there, and his name escapes me at the moment, his grave site is maintained. And in communities all across the South, including here in Tallahassee, there is a community, a remembrance project where we are acknowledging the men and women who were lynched in these various communities. And so I know in Orlando or in Orange County, they've done that. There is a lynching marker. We will be placing one here in Tallahassee early next year. The marker actually arrived in Tallahassee this week. It's been a process, something that we've been working on for several years, and this is going on in several communities. So I know with Ocoee, there's a very active organization. Many of my graduate students have written of racial violence. One of my graduate students Megan Martinez wrote about the incident in Perry. And she also uncovered one that we had been unaware of in Baker County. So research is being done. And I think because of EJI, the Equal Justice Initiative, that more communities will be getting involved in these things. I know there was a master's thesis done many, many, many years ago on Ocoee, and the research on that has increased substantially. So we know what happened at Ocoee. We still don't know a lot about incidents in other communities, but I think EJI is encouraging many communities to look into racial terror and racial violence.
Where will that marker be, Maxine? Will that be down in Smoky Hollow, or where will that be put?
It will be near Smoky Hollow. We've worked very hard to put this marker in a place of some relevance. And the four documented lynchings, we know there are more than four lynchings in Leon County, but the four that have been documented, they were all taken from the Leon County Jail, which is on Gaines Street, right on the edge of Cascades Park. And we've gotten permission from the city to place the marker. There's a huge oak tree there. It's not the lynching tree. A lot of people think it's the lynching tree, but it's not. But we're going to make that spot a sacred space and place the marker there in February. There will be a ceremony and the public will be invited to attend. We've been looking for family members. We haven't had much luck yet, but we will keep searching.
Thank you. I know Nadine Long, who and her son, Darian Pollock, have been working in Jackson County. That's for there to be a memorial, but apparently they have met resistance from the city council or the county council, whoever has been asked to vote on it.
Right. Well, they wanted to, and this deals with the lynching of Claude Neal, a brutal lynching. This black man was accused of murdering a young white woman. And he was tortured. I mean, really, he was tortured. And it wasn't unusual in lynchings and in incidents of racial violence, as I stated, you know, before. And I won't go into any of the gruesome details. But the tree from which he was lynched is still there. And from what I gather, they want to cut down the tree, which I don't necessarily, you know, agree with, but I don't live in that community. But they want to cut down the tree. And I think that's where the resistance, you know, is coming from. But one of our graduate students in the College of Communications, he graduated, I guess, about 2 years ago. He wrote his dissertation on Claude Neal and the effort to get an anti-lynching bill passed. So research is being done, you know, on all of these, you know, incidents of racial violence. You know, so they've been buried, but they are, you know, coming to light, it seems.
So we have several links in the chat room. And also on the TallahasseeChon.org, our website, that I think are to your report, Dr. Jones, but if not, we'll definitely put that up. But I think we do have that posted. So just a couple of people are asking where to get it. Do you have it on your, on the Department of History's website or any place?
Well, if you just, many, 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 many years ago, I had a copy on the internet, but it's been years since I've checked. I think the state Archives probably has a copy, you know, available. I know the FSU library has a couple of copies. I don't know if they've been digitized yet, but I suspect if you go to the internet and just type in the Rosewood report, it'll probably okay. pop up.
Okay. V. Miller, you want to ask your question?
Sure, Fran, thanks. Okay, so let's see. Originally, well, first, thank you, Professor Jones. This has been sobering, but also very informative. Originally, I worded my question as, what made the story of Rosewood resonate so widely in 1993? And have those conditions changed and how? But I'm wondering if I can nuance that a bit and say, you know, what makes the story of Rosewood vis-a-vis all the other, you know, pervasive instances of racial violence in Florida? What made Rosewood as a story, as an incident, sort of stand out to Florida legislatures in 1993 in a way that all this other terrible racial violence, you know, hasn't? At least to their eyes, maybe not yet. Does that make sense?
Well, yeah, it does. I would like to think that it was the pro bono work done by Steve Hallin and Martha Barnett. Again, Hallin and Knight is the largest law firm, you know, in the state. And Barnett and Hanlon, they were, you know, they put their heart and soul into this. And I think after meeting the survivors, I think they fell in love with them and they wanted to represent them. And they also understood that in this country, you don't have money, you don't have anything. And Steve Hanlon was telling the story. He met with me, he and I met with Congressman Yoho a couple of weeks ago. And he said Ike Tribble, who was in Tampa and at one time was in charge of the Mike Knight Foundation, of the Mike Knight Scholarship Fund, that when he buried his mother, all he had left was debt. And I think the fact that many of the people who lived in Rosewood own their homes, they owned land. Not all of them were, you know, middle class and rich, but some of the houses were lavishly, you know, furnished. They had pianos, they had glass windows and so forth. All of that went up in ashes. And so these people who came from, you know, a middle class, you know, background, didn't get to inherit what their parents, you know, had worked for them. And Steve Hanlon understood this. And Martha Barnett had actually grown up with the children of some of the survivors of Rosewood. And I think that made a difference. They had a representation, and that representation, I think, made the difference. And it's not like the state didn't, you know, put up a case. You know, as Richard Hickson said, this case probably would not stand in a court of law. But it was the moral obligation of the state to protect its citizens. And the state of Florida failed. The state of Florida failed in even trying to help these people go back and reclaim, you know, their lives. And so I think that resonated with Hanlon and Barnett. And then having these survivors tell their gripping stories, I think made all the difference in the world. And let me also say that we were told that there were more survivors. Only 9 will come forward. We were told that there wasn't enough money in the world to make these people, you know, come out of hiding. And, you know, we don't know how many people actually died at Rosewood. You know, people talk about mass graves, which FDLE was unable to find. We know that some people, especially the men, they disappeared, they changed their names. And so we don't know what happened, you know, to them. But initially, eight came forward. After the legislature awarded the money, one more, you know, came forward. But it was a riveting story. And these kids, these people who were kids at the time, who had been scarred, you know, by this, if you heard them tell their story, I think, you know, it moved you. And so I think having the right representation, having a survivors, really, really made a difference.
Understood. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. So let's see. Well, actually, whites or white legislators supportive of the reparations? I mean, was there a real racial divide in terms of how that vote went?
No, I don't think so. And let me just say that I think the attorneys were very careful not to use the word reparations. It was a claims bill. And, you know, claim bills have been, you know, part of the process for a long time. So this was a claims bill and not a reparations bill. There was concern about who would come out of the woodworks once money was awarded. So they wanted to make sure that there were no loopholes. And I can't really go into any details about it. It's just that they wanted to make sure that once the bill was passed, you could have, you know, 2,000 people, you know, claiming to be, you know, descendants of Rosewood. But there was bipartisan support. White legislators had to support it in order for the bill to pass.
Good. Thank you. There's a question about, have you kept up, have there been other either reparations or claims made by states since then? Or is this still a unique situation?
I think it's unique in the sense that money exchanged hands. I think, and I really don't know enough to claim that I'm an expert, but I think in places like Tulsa, there's money to help rebuild, you know, Black Wall Street. But I don't think individual families received money. And can I also say that with this case, in presenting this case before the legislature, they had an economist who went back and you know, looked at property records and said how much that property would be worth in 1994. And they also had a psychologist who talked to the survivors and who talked about PTSD. I think they had their bases, you know, covered, and they presented a complete picture of what these people, you know, had to go through. You know, again, they lost so much, and then having to live in fear of white people. I mean, I think that fear, you know, was already there, but you know, Minnie Lee Langley, in her testimony, you know, she talked about, you know, those crackers, you know, is what she called them. And these people, they find a way to rebuild their lives. They're not filled with hate, but they don't trust white people. They just refuse to trust white people. They knew that white people could find them. And so that's one reason why they remained, you know, silent, because they were afraid that what had happened at Rosewood could actually happen, you know, again. So Rosewood was buried. But again, all of that built up, you know, whatever it was released when they got to testify at the hearings. And again, their stories are just riveting, really gripping.
Dr. Mason, you want to ask a second question? And if other people have a question, please just either raise your hand or preferably write it in the chat room so I see that you have something.
Yes, I was curious to know to what extent did political or economic competition from African Americans or desire for Black independence, to what extent did that motivate the attack, right? Because sometimes in lynchings, the motivating factor was sometimes African Americans, especially men, trying to be politically or economically independent or competitive.
I'm sure it did. I know with Sylvester Carrier, he was very independent. He was a proud Black man, and he stood up for his the women, you know, in his family. And I remember a story. Maybe some white men had said something to some of the female members of his family, and he wasn't going to just take it. And so I think he probably said something back, you know, to the white man, or he went and said, "Don't, you know, mess with my cousin or my sister, you know," or something like that. And the fact that he didn't kowtow to whites, you know, might have played a role, because it's his house, it's the Carrier house that they go to, you know, on that Thursday night. Out of all of the houses in Rosewood, they go there. And the Carriers were among the wealthier ones, in Rosewood. And, you know, Sarah Carrier was considered the matriarch of Rosewood, but she was shot and killed, you know, that first night. You know, whites reputedly, you know, respected her, but she's among the first to, you know, die. But I'm sure that they were probably, and we always blame this on poor whites, and I'm not sure if, you know, poor whites are necessarily, you know, the ones to, you know, blame all the time. But if you are poor, and you know that there are Blacks who live in your area and they have nice homes and, you know, nice furnishings and stuff, it might bother you, you know, a little bit. It might bother you that this Black family isn't necessarily dependent on whites for their earnings. So I'm sure that there was some of that there. And if we looked at the economic, you know, situation in the early 1820s in Florida, we could probably build a strong case for that.
Thank you.
Thank you. Gwagu, the founder of the Tallahassee Chan Center, you have a question. Dr. Jimmy, you also a religion professor.
Sorry, I had trouble unmuting myself. I'd like to thank you so much for sharing your knowledge, your experience. Talk was very moving, very powerful. My question was that, is there or was there a concerted move to share with other Black communities, other states, other regions, elsewhere, the strategic steps taken to win the case at Rosewood? we live. So the question came out of a wish that this case would be more widely known. Repeated for reparations. You talked about proper representation, and having their grounds covered, psychologists, real estate agents, or economists. So these things, I guess I'm wishing that it would be kind of collected and disseminated in this information age that we're in. So.
Well, in November, I'm going to be on a panel at a conference dealing with reparations. It's being sponsored by Northeastern University in Boston, I believe. Mm-hmm. And I'll get to share some of what happened, in Florida. There is a move to seek reparations for the American descendants of slaves, in this country. And I'm assuming that that's what this, conference is about, gathering, information from other cases, be it Greenwood in Tulsa, where they're getting money to rebuild, that part of the city, or Rosewood, or whatever. So there is an effort, underway to collect this kind of information. And again, Rosewood was in the media. And so that information, is out there. And as I said, a book has been written about the legislative process, the academic report. Steve Hanlon is still active, and he met with Yoho a week or so ago. So people are seeking the knowledge, and we are eager to share it.
Okay. I don't see any other questions here. I have a question to ask you. Since you specialize in African American history in Florida, are there other kinds of positive stories about African Americans in Florida that are also part of a national movement? I know the Equal Justice Initiative has really been very powerful to get recognition for lynching and for the horrible criminal justice system's persecution of Blacks without representation and so forth. I guess I'm just asking you, as a historian of African American history in Florida, what other kinds of affinity groups there are in African American history in Florida?
Well, I don't know if I can point to anything specific, but various communities are active. I know in Miami there's an African American museum, that is very active here. We have the Riley House. With EJI, we have the CRPs, in various communities. Mm-hmm. Various communities are trying to preserve the Black sections of town. They're turning segregated schools into, museums. So it just depends on, what area that you're in. I know in Jacksonville, there's a museum there that is very active in reclaiming Black history. One of our graduates is one of the directors there. So there are these small groups. I'm sure there's probably a national umbrella group that brings all of these all of these small entities, you know, together. But I can't necessarily point to that one organization.
Okay, thank you.
But I do think Black communities are trying to reclaim their history and their identity.
Yeah, excellent. So actually, had the reparations or the claims, as you rightly call them, been paid from the 1993 legislation?
Yes. The nine people got $150,000, and then smaller amounts were awarded to others based on how much land, you know, their families owned. And, you know, the attorneys warned, you know, the families that not to let the distribution of the funds destroy them. And because some, you know, I haven't looked at these records in years, but I know, you know, some people got $300, some got, you know, $33 and, you know, varying amounts. And that can actually, you know, divide instead of bringing, you know, people, you know, together. Mm-hmm. So whether or not the entire 2.1 was distributed or not, I don't know, but I do know that a large amount of that was.
Okay, thank you. Someone asked you to comment on what you think the likelihood that reparations will be paid. I don't know if that's, you know, about national reparations or exactly, but do you think there's any chance that that will be taken up?
Well, I have a friend who seems to think that if there's a change of administrations, that this will be an issue put forth before the next Congress. But like him, I don't think, and we do have an economist here, Dr. Mason, I don't think there's going to be an exchange of money. I think, you know, free college tuition, maybe some type of, I don't want to use the word loan, but some type of financing to enable people to purchase homes. But I don't think the U.S., and I hope I'm wrong, but I don't think the U.S. government is going to write any American descendant of slavery a check. But I'm not an economist. I honestly don't know. And just the word reparations scares people. It just, I don't know.
Yeah. Maxine, we need to wrap up. This has been a wonderful time to share and to hear and to learn. I guess, you know, you spent a lot of time and, you know, you've really been thoughtful in thinking this all through this whole long history. What do you think are the most important lessons to learn from this? Just, you know, if you were asked to kind of give a short summary.
Well, we don't know our history. We don't know the violence. We don't know of the violence that built this country. We don't acknowledge slavery. We don't acknowledge racial oppression. And until we do, these things are going to keep, you know, happening. Until we can see each other as being just interconnected, instead of seeing each other as the other, these things are going to keep, you know, happening. And I think we need to know our history. We need to own it. We need to confront it. We need to talk about these things. We need to ask questions. about poverty and why the face of poverty in this country is black or brown. I hope what I do and what I've said here tonight encourages people to ask questions. I think once we start asking, you know, questions, we might find out some very important, you know, lessons.
Well, thank you so much. I wish we could collectively clap for you, but this has been wonderful, Dr. Jones, and we appreciate your sharing with us.
Thank you. It's been my pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you.
You guys enjoy the rest of your evening.
Yeah, you too.
Thank you.
And I guess people are leaving, but next Tuesday we'll have discussion groups to talk more about your feelings and experiences about what Dr. Jones has talked about. So join us again next Tuesday at 7:30 so that we can share together. Thank you. Good night.
Bye-bye.